Can you read the text?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay. So so we are so this
yes,
is
sir, this is fine.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. So we are going to discuss about data structures in this course. So data structures are used to structure your data, so information. So for a program, so if you for example, if you write a program, you need So if you write a program, okay. So if you write a program, software programs, so you need an input or data. Usually we use data as an input. So it can be from the computer, it can be from internet, it can be from a database, it can be from anywhere. It can be a user input, and then we write or process this data. So to process the data, we use algorithms. Okay. So to use data, so we need data structures. So we have to structure the data. So for that, we use data structures, because the data cannot we have to structure them, otherwise we cannot access them in the algorithm. So this course is basically we address these two parts. So usually to write any program, we need to access this data. Okay, so we will learn about data structures and algorithms in this course. Okay. Okay, so do you have any questions? Up to here. Sorry, there was a mistake. Problem with my connection. Okay. So for data structures. Okay. For data structures, we will be using mainly first learn about data structures. Okay. The data structures, mainly there are two sections, so two parts. One is physical, and the other one is called logical. Okay, so we divide data structures into two parts. Physical means uh, physical means it's in the I mean we store data in the computer, and the physically we store them according to that structure. Okay, so there are two ways. One is physical data structures, the other one is logical data structures. So the physical ones, the first one, you know, it is an array. So in an array, if you declare, if you create an array, it's physical. Physically, you will have this kind of memory structure in the computer memory. And then we have linked structures. Okay. So those are like, so we have something like this. Okay. It can be something like this. So we have links and data. So we will come into that later. And then we have logical. So we will discuss them later. So one is called stack, and the other one is called queue. Then we have trees, graphs, and hash tables. Are some examples. So we will discuss them later. So first, we want to start with arrays. Okay, so I think you know, all of you know, we have used it in the previous lectures. About array, we have discussed it and we have used it in our previous lectures. Okay, so what is an array? So array is something like this. So you can create an array in the memory. Okay, like, so for example, you can create an integer array. Okay, A, like this. Say, so here 1 2 3 4 5 6, so we have 6, and in C you have to put the semicolon after the creation. So when you do that, so you have a type, okay, and a name, and then you have size. So to create an array, you need this thing. So before that, okay, so this is, you know, this is smaller. Okay, so this is a name. So it's a variable. So you all know this now. Okay, it's a variable name. So what is a variable? Okay, and what kind of variables we have? So for example, we have different kind of variables. So for example, can anybody tell me what happens here? So I need you to answer these questions. It doesn't matter. So what happens here? So you, when you create integer A, what happens here? What happens in the memory? Can anybody answer the question? Otherwise, I have to name you and ask to answer the question. So you don't worry. I mean, it's not like a lecture. So nobody sees you or nobody is with you. So just answer the question. So you must start answering questions. Otherwise, it's very difficult to continue lecture. Okay. Can one of you answer the question? So the question is, So what happened when you do something like this, integer A? So what happens in the memory?
It allocates a space for the integer.
Yeah, so you will create a space for one integer. So only one integer is created. Okay, so you will have something like this in the memory, and you will have a name for that location, and usually you will have 4 bytes for integer. And so this is it. So we call them scalars, scalar variable. Scalar means only one. And then we have something like this. Okay. So you can have a variable something like this. So what is the what happens here? Anyone?
P is a pointer variable which points the address.
Yeah. So so here also we create a variable. So it's a variable, and what happens here is you can only create a pointer variable. We can only store addresses here. Okay, so here we can store values, and here you store addresses. So you cannot store values here. Okay, so this value is a, so address is a memory address. So the memory addresses are, we denote them by hexadecimal numbers like A, F, whatever. So we will see this later. So we have hash mark as well in the beginning. Sorry, not hash mark, 0x, something like that. Denote a hexadecimal number. So this is a location, and this location points to a, any location. So it can store the address of this memory. So how to do it is P equals address of the normal variable A. So here this is a normal variable. So we have discussed this earlier, but you have to learn them very thoroughly, because this is the foundation for data structures. So if you know, if you write any program, you have to know this very well. Okay, and so you can see now. So this is the address of A. That means the location of this memory in the RAM. Okay, so the memory value, the memory address is stored here now. Okay, so now, so how do you access this using P? Okay, so you if you say star, so if you say star P, that means, this means go to address P. P is an address. So you know the value of P is an address, and get the value. So you know this. So I will show you this in the program as well. Okay, so we will have a practical session soon, and we will see how to do it. Okay, so this is two type of variable. So you know, address type variable, pointer type variable, and normal value type variable. Okay, and then sorry. Then you have the arrays. Arrays is like a vector. Okay, so vector is a you know what is vector? Vector is a set of numbers. So you can create an vector variable or array variable like this. Okay, so you have a name same as the other variables. You have a name for this vector variable. We call it arrays. Okay, so when you get a vector variable or array variable, you will create something like this, and you have the indexes to access these different locations. Okay, so using A, you can access this location, this one, and this one, and this one. So if you want to access the first location of the array, because array is a vector, you use the index. So this is the index, okay, and you can use that to access different locations. So you can access second location like this, third location, the first location like this. Okay, so using your index, you can access different places. Okay, so this how can you declare your locations array? So you can declare your array. You can give integer and something like this. So this is one way of creating an array. So we will see there are different ways of creating an arrays. So here what happened is, so this is one way of creating an array. Okay. Hello. Hello. Can you hear me?
There was a power. Yes, sir.
Okay. There was a power failure as well. So I thought the router is off. Okay. So now, so we can create an array like this. So what happened here is, so you create a variable A. Okay, variable A, and it will allocate 6 consecutive memory locations. So the memory locations are consecutive, or it we call it contiguous. The memory locations are one next to the other. So we'll start here. So if you have, say, here 6, so you will create 6 integers, 6 × 4 bytes memory. So then so you will create this much of memory in the computer. So this is how it happens. Okay, so we will first see how to do it, and then see, so I will show you how to do it using a program. Okay, so I will stop sharing this now. Okay. So I will show you now. So since some of you don't have computers, so I will show you how to do it online as well. So one of the best website is called Repl. So you just type Repl. The website Repl in the browser, and then go to this repl.it website. Okay, so this is free actually. So when you go, so I will log out. I will log out and see. So you can sign up here or log in depending on what you have. Okay, so I will log in here, and then you can use either of your Gmail or GitHub or Facebook account. And so I'm using my GitHub account to log in, because if you do it, you can save your work. Okay, so this is free, and there's a size for this. Only 500 MB is allowed for free version, and you cannot have private programs, so others can see your program. It doesn't matter. After you log into this repl.it site, you can create a new repl, and here you can select your language. So there are some lots of languages you can use. So I'm going to select C++, and I will create 2301.1 or whatever, any name. You can give any name for your repl. Okay, so this will actually allocate C++ machine, Linux machine, virtual machine for you, and you can see your code in this side. So I will close that, and you have two versions. One is your code. So I want to see how to increase the size. Font size large. Can you see the font size is large enough for you to read?
Yes, sir. Yes, okay. Sir.
Can you read? Okay. So you can see, so you can run this. You can just run it using this run button. Okay. Or you can type the Linux commands. Okay. So I will type clear to clear the prompt, and then you can type G++, which is the GNU C++ compiler, and main.cpp is the file name. So you can see the file name here. So my file name is main.cpp, and I can press enter. Okay, so then you can see, when you go to the here, you can see that a.out file, which is a executable file, has been created. Okay, so you can see it here by typing ls as well, list. So you can see we have a.out file and main cc. In this one, actually, I have created just before. So you can compile gcc main.cpp, and you can give the object name minus o and say main. So this will create the main file. So you can run this one /main. So it is same as the normal C++ terminal. Okay, So I will start changing it now using namespace std, and I will remove this part, hello world. So now it is similar. This is my text, and you type end line. Okay, and now you can save it, and you go, you compile it, okay, and you can run it. Okay, so you can see this is one way of programming. If you have a smartphone also, you can do it. So that is why I have asked you to use this online compiler. So I will upload setting up the C++ environment, how to do it with Linux, Windows, Visual Studio and Windows WSL. So I will upload those videos to data structures as well. Actually, it was, they were made for a C programming, but it is similar in C++ as well. So almost all of you should have this development, one of development environment. Otherwise, it will be very difficult to follow the course. Okay. So now, we will we have this, and we will see. Now, first we will create a variable A. Okay, so you create a variable A and you assign some value, and now you can print the value and end line as well. And so now you compile it, and the, you can see you have the output 10 here. Okay, so now what you have to do is, we will see, we will print the address of this. So how do you print the address? So you know, if you have a normal variable, you can get the address using ampersand mark and A, and this is okay. So you can see, so you have to put some space in between, otherwise what happened? G++, what, something happened, main dot cpp minus o main. Okay, so you can see now, so you print the value of A and the address of A. So you, it start with 0x, that means it's a hexadecimal number, and then you have hexadecimal value of the address. So it's a very large number, because you have 64 bit computer we have. So you, this is 64 bit. Okay, so you have one hexadecimal number is 4 bit. So you should have 4 into 16, 4 into 8, 4 into 16, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. Okay, so 16 values, because it's a 64 bit compiler. Okay, so this is the first type of program. The other one is creating a pointer variable. So now what happened is, so you create a variable. So this is also variable. So you can output this value and see. So you compile it and run it. So you can see now this variable, we are printing the value of this variable p. Okay, so here if we just print a, it will print the value of that variable 10, and if it is a pointer variable here, it will print the value of that pointer, that means the stored value. So it's an address, okay, but we haven't initialized it, so it will print the address value. And if you print the address of p, so you can print the address of p as well. So now we can see, so we have to print some space in between. So you can see this is the value of p and this is the address of p. Any variable should have address, because any variable, we create them in the memory, computer memory, and this variable a is having an address and variable p is having an address, and variable a is having a value and variable p is having a value. That value is an address because it's, the type is different. So this is a different type of variable, and we can initialize this one to address of a. So address of a is a value, and address of a can be stored here. Okay, so now you can see, so the address of a is value of a is 10, the address of a is this one, and we store it in variable p. So you can see, so this one and this one are same. So that means we store the, now p contains address of a. So how do you print the value of a using pointer p? Okay, so we have done it. So this meaning, this is the meaning of this. So p is a pointer. So when you say asterisk p, it goes to the value of p. Value of p is, what is the value of p? Is the address of a. So it goes to a, the place a, and get the value and print it. So it should print 10 here. Okay. So you can see now. So this is this three concepts we discuss in the first two semesters. So you should know of this, and you you have to read about it. Okay, the pointers. So I will give you some references. Just read about pointers and understand the pointers well, because we will be using these pointers over and over again. Okay. So now the arrays, array variable. So we have scalar variables, pointer variables, and then array variables. Okay. So how do you create an array? Fine. So this is how we create an array. So how do you print an array? So we need an for loop to print an array. I equals 0, I less than 5, I plus plus is the loop, I plus plus, okay, C out, A, I. So you did this in the previous lecture, a previous semester, so you should know. So we will put a comma, and finally, we put C out in line. Okay, new line. And now we will see. How it happens. Okay. So I will clear the screen. Can you read, can you see this so the output is in the back black background. So can you see this? Can you read this black background?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So you can see now. So here the for loop is running and it print 5 numbers, and the numbers are, so you have, you can see there's a problem here. Okay, so there's a problem. Okay. Okay. So there's a problem with the output. So you can see these values are garbage values. That means we haven't initialized. In some modern languages, you are not allowed to do this. Okay. So when you create this array, it will allocate memory addresses. So we will print the memory addresses as well. Okay. So after that, below this, I will copy this loop. Okay. So I will copy this loop, and instead of so here I am printing the value of AI, and here I am printing the address of AI. So we will see compiling and running. So you can see now. Okay. So end line should be here as well. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So now you can see, so the values are these garbage values and the addresses are, so you have 270 274, the same value, and then 270 280. So you can see from here to here you have 4 bytes. So these are in bytes. So the starting address of first memory location is 270, and starting address of second memory location is 274. That means from 4 bytes so you have something like this here. Okay, the first memory location is this one, and the second memory location is this one. So you have 4 bytes from here to here. So you have 270 and 274, and the next one is, so the, I told you that these are consecutive memory location. That is why they are consecutive. So after 8, so after 8 you have 9, 10 means A, 11 means B, and so after 4, after 8, if you add 8 plus 4, it is C. So 27C, and then from C, if you add 4, C, D, E, F, and again 0. So it will be 280. So this memory location is this one, and the final one is this one. So when you start, when you access a variable, so the address of a variable means the first place, first address of the that 4 bytes. So if you have an integer, it's 4 bytes. So the address is 4 bytes. The first byte address is the address. Okay, so you can see now. So you have something like this. Okay. Okay. So this is how you create an array. Okay. So I will use so I will stop sharing this and I will start my Visual Studio and show you how to use that one to create in the same program. Okay. So Visual Studio I have loaded. Okay. Share screen. Okay. So when you have Visual Studio installed, so I will put an video how to install Visual Studio. So this is one of the most famous and most easy to use IDE for programming in Windows for C Sharp and C and C++. It's very easy to use. So so you can create a project here, and I'm using C++ console project, and you press next and give a name, okay, and create. Okay, and the sharing stops because that window switched to another window. So I will start sharing again by C Sharp. This thing. Okay, can you see the Visual Studio now?
Yes.
Okay, so you have the Solution Explorer. So there are some files and source files and header files or whatever. So you have the main file. So I will delete these comments to make it clear, and these comments as well. So it's the same thing. Okay. I will increase the size to 150 maybe. Okay. So now, so you have the same program. So I will use namespace here as well. Okay, and I will remove this std here. Okay, so now you can run it. Well, so you cannot see the results now. Because it's in another window. Okay, how do I do this? Share portion of screen. Okay, can you see the Visual Studio now? Hello. Hello. There are no black boxes and anything. So okay, so now if I run this, can you see the results now?
Yes, sir.
So you can see the hello world here.
Yes.
Okay. Okay. So I will do like this because I cannot share one application because otherwise you cannot see the other one. Okay. So now we will do the same thing. So you can create an integer a with 5. So now I am not printing it. I will put a breakpoint. Okay, so the breakpoints are very important in programming. Okay, so what you can do with breakpoints, you can stop the program in the middle, because if you run it, you can see it just running. Okay, it runs and it exists. Okay, so we cannot do anything. But if you put a breakpoints. So I will show you how to put breakpoints in. There are some online compilers you can put breakpoints. So I will show it later. So here I will put a breakpoint. So there's an hash line here in Visual Studio in the left hand side. You can put a breakpoint. So and you put a breakpoint and then you press local debugger. And now you can see your program is stopped here. Okay. And now you can examine the variables, local variables inside this one. So you have only one variable. So you can examine it. Okay. So when you move the mouse here, you can see it shows the address of the first address is 0x0110FFA86. And then the five values. So you can see the values are garbage values because we haven't initialized these values. Okay. And then, so here also in the this window, you can see A and the first value, and then the five values you can see here. Okay. So I will use this. Because then you don't want to print the variables. So I can inspect all these variables while the programming is running. Okay. And you can easily see what's going on. So we use this to find errors in the program. So you can inspect the you can run this line by line and see what is going on inside the program. Okay, so I will stop it. Okay, so now you know how to create an array. And now you should know how to initialize an array. So you can initialize an array like this. Okay, so you can give values in a curly braces. So you can give inside a curly braces. So for example, you can say int a equals 10. So this is how you initialize a normal variable. But to initialize an array variable, so you have to give curly braces like this, and then you can use some values. Now we will run this and see the output inside the breakpoint. So you have two variables now, capital A and simple A. The simple A variable contains number 10, and capital A variables is a, actually it's a pointer. You can see the address value, and inside that pointer you have five values: 0, 1, 2nd, 3rd, 4th position, and the values are 1, 2, 3, 4, 7. So this is the way we can initialize an array. Okay. And then there are some other ways of doing it as well. Okay. The another way. So I will create another array, int b 5. And you create, so I will stop this. You can do something like this. Okay, so what happens here? So you should give a semicolon, otherwise there's an error. You can see there's an error here. Yeah? So you give a semicolon here. Okay, so now what happens? So you cannot have same variable. So I will give a different variable name. So now we have three variables, local variables, and I will run this up to the breakpoint. And you can see all these three values are here. So you can see, so this value is in a different memory location, and this array is a different memory location. And you can see this one now initialized to 0. Okay. So when you do like this, the variable is initialized to 0. So this is another way of initializing an array. We will check another way. what happens? So another array of size 5, the same size I am using, and we will write say 2 and 3, something like this, and we need a semicolon, and we will run this now. And array C. So what has happened to array C? So you have two values only. So first two values will be initialized to 2 and 4, and the rest of the values so are initialized to zeros because we haven't given the values. Okay. And if you don't initialize, what happens? We will have garbage values. X. So I will run this. So you can see X. That's X. It hasn't show us the variable D, maybe this compiler is detecting uninitialized value. Okay, so in different compilers behave differently, so I will show you this in normal compiler. Okay, and then we will see. So what happens, you create an integer D 5 and you initialize the values to 3, 5 values. Okay. And you can see D is initialized like this 2, 4, 5, 6, 8, 8. Okay. And something like that. So now we will print. I will use the for loop. So for int I equals 0 I less than say 5 I plus plus. So C out D I. So I'm printing the value of D and put a space in between. And see our end line here. Okay. So if I will remove the breakpoint and I will run this. And you can see okay. So you can see the values are printed. 2, 4, 5, 6, 8, 8. Okay. So you start the for loop I equals 0. And you run I less than 5 times and increase I by 1. Okay, you see out D I position. So D0, D1, D2, D3, D4 will be printed. So it was printed. So what happens now? So if we increase this to 10, so now what is the problem here? Okay, do you see any problems with this code? Can anyone tell me what is the problem in this code?
Iteration exceeds the array.
Sorry?
Iteration exceeds the array.
Yeah, so what happens then? What should happen? So what will happen? So in some languages, C sharp, Java, you are not allowed to do it. So if you do this, it will throw an exception. Exception means an error message saying that the program will stop, saying the array out of bound. Array out of bound means it goes out of bound, out of the allocated memory. But we will run this one and see what happens here. Okay, so you can see it doesn't check anything. Okay, it just run the code 0th location 4, 5, 6, 8, 8. So after this, the array okay, so you can see so up to here, so you have the array 0, 1, 2, 3. So this is the 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. So you have array of 5, and so you have 5, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 means 5. So this is D. And so we are going, so if we say this is 5, okay, so it will iterate only 4 times because I equals 0, I equals 1 is working, 2 is working, 3 is working. When I is 5, this statement falls, so the loops break and you will not go into the loop and this will not be printed. But now, so we are having 10, okay, so then, so it will go from 0 to 9. Okay, that means you will print A4, A5, and then this location. We don't know what is here. We don't know. So we have, we don't know what is here. But it, so you take the these 4 bytes, okay, and convert it to an integer because so we are asking to print an integer array value. So take these 4 bytes and print it. So you can see the value is this. Okay, and then take the next 4 bytes and print it. And the next 4 bytes, you can see you have 2 here. We don't know if it may be from another program because we are accessing outside our memory. So this can be the same program memory or it can be another program. So it can be another program, maybe operating system or some unauthorized memory. Okay, and then the next one is 4. Somebody has put 4 here, and the next one is 0. Somebody has put 0 here, but these memory does not belongs to our program. Okay, but we can access it in C, C++. So that is why these two languages are more powerful. Okay, so you can access memory beyond our allocations, any location without any problem. Okay, so this is in a way it's very good, but you can make lots of mistakes and you can make viruses, those kind of hacks using C programs because you can access this memory outside this one and you can change some values in the other programs as well if you want sometimes. Okay, so because of that, so you have to be very careful in C. You have to manually check the bounds of your program. Okay, okay, so how do you remove this annotation? Okay, so now you can do it. So now, so this is only reading. Okay. So we will check whether we can write. Okay. We say 9. It was 0 earlier, and we will going to write something. Okay. And we are going to print it. So this is not our memory. It's someone else's memory. Okay. And we will see what happens. Okay, it works. Okay. So we will print everything. Instead of this one, we will print all the values. Okay. So you manage to change the this memory location as well. So you can change the memory as well. So this memory does not belong to ourselves, our program. So we haven't allocated those memory, so it doesn't belong to us, but we can access them, read them, change them. So this is a very powerful but scary. So you can crash our other programs as well. Okay, so we will see. So this is very close. So we will see whether we can do something like 10,000. Okay, so we start with this memory location, and after 10,000 bytes, or 10,000 bytes, this is not 10,000. This is 1,000,000. Okay, bytes. Now it will be 4,000,000 bytes. It will be 4,000,000 bytes means 4 around 4 MB memory. Okay, so you can allocate them, but what we are going to first we will print it. Okay, so I'm going to print. So first I'm going to print, see how whether we can, sometimes we may be able to access, we don't know. Okay. That's a problem. Okay. There's an exception called, that means access violation reading location. So it must be accessing some unauthorized memory, maybe operating system, because the operating system memory is not allowed to be accessed by the other program. So here, because we are accessing so far from our allocated memory, so we may be going into operating system memory. Okay, so then we will have some error messages. So if you here, if you try to write it, maybe say 1,000. As well. Okay, still there's an exception. That means still it is accessing unauthorized memory. So now it's working. That means so it is it doesn't access unauthorized memory. So it works here. So you can see, even though we haven't allocated that memory, we have allocated only 5 variables 5 integers, but we can access this memory outside our program. So this is one issue with C. So you must be very careful when handling arrays or any variables, pointers, how to use them. Okay. Then the next concept we should learn. Okay, I will start again. So now the next thing we want to discuss is stack memory and heap memory. So we learned this concept earlier as well, but okay, so we discuss about memory different two. There are two memory types in here. One is heap memory, the other one is stack memory. Okay, so these are two type of memory. So stack memory is very fast to create, and access is also fast access. Okay, and here it is slow. So why should then why we should use heap memory and stack memory? Okay, so we can do anything in stack memory. We can create arrays. We can do anything in stack memory. So if you say, for example, if you say something like int a 10, okay, okay, so you can create stack memory like this. So if you create integer a or int x, so in okay, sorry, there are some disturbances. So when you do something like this, so you know you create these variables in stack. Okay, so you can see you can create normal variable arrays. You can do anything in the stack, and they are fast as well. And here it is slow. And why should we use heap is the issue. So what is stack memory? So we have to first see how the memory works. Okay, so you have first in the RAM, you have when you create your program, you start your program, you will have your software code. All your code in the program will be loaded to the memory, and then you will have him. Okay, memory, and the other part is you have stack memory. So your memory allocated to your program will be divided into three parts. Okay, stack, heap, and this thing. So we will write a simple program. So for example, so you have integer main. Okay, so this is the main program we are starting. So we have integer x, and we have another variable integer y, and then we call a function func a. So this is our main program, and then our then you have the function, say void func a. So can you read this handwriting?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So then you have integer here a. Okay. Now only this. So when you run the program, all these code will be loaded to the memory. And then the code is in the bottom somewhere here. Your code is loaded, and then you have stack memory. So first, for each function, you have a separate stack. Not only function, actually, each scope. So this is very important. Each scope. So function is a scope. Scope means we will have different scope. I will show you in an example what is a scope. Okay, function is a scope. Okay, and even for loop is also a scope. Okay, so this is our main program. So this is the main stack for main. Stack means one after the other. So we will have in the main x, variable x, and variable y, memory for this one. And then what we do is we here call a function. So when you call a function, your program counter or your program start from here. Okay, it's a new scope. So you will load another, create another stack here. So this is func a. So this is another stack. So you create a variable a here. Okay. So you do something, and here, from here you exit. So this is the, when you call the function, you start here, you go here, and then you go here, and you exit and come here. You return. So actually, you return to here. Value, if there's a value, you return to here, but here it's a void, so you don't return anything. So when after you call it, you come here. Okay, when you come here, you delete this stack. Okay, so this is what happens in a stack memory. So when you call a function, you create a new stack. If you call a function from here, function B, okay, so you call another stack here, from here. And when you return from this one, you delete this one, and then you delete this one, and finally you will come here, and finally you will delete this one when you exit from your main program. Okay, so this is how a stack works. So a stack works like this. So you go this way, and you have to come this way. So you, when you call a function, you go up and up and up, stack your memory, like this stack means a book of stack. So you create a pile, one on top of the other. That is the meaning of stack. So the problem here is, so when you are here, when you are in this stack, you cannot delete memory here. So that is the problem with stack. So deleting and allocating happens in this way. So you cannot delete randomly. Okay, so you cannot allocate randomly, you cannot delete randomly. So the memory will be allocated one after the other, and deletion also should happen the one after the other in the other way. So this is first allocation, second allocation, third allocation, and when you are deleting, this is first for deleting, this is second for deleting, and this is the final one for deleting. So this is the problem in stack. Okay, this is not a problem, this is how the stack behaves. So because of this, so when you allocate large memory or somewhere, if you want to delete it, we cannot do it in random order. Okay, so in stack, we cannot delete randomly. Okay, it should be the reverse order of created. Okay, so this is the problem. Okay. Okay, so we have 10 minutes or around 15 minutes. Okay. Okay, so then, I'm writing it again. Integer main function. Okay, so we have integer x, and we call the function a. And we have func a here, and we have integer y here, and I am creating a pointer here, p, and allocate memory in the stack. So so to allocate memory in the stack, we know we have to use new. So if you just say integer b10 here, okay, somewhere here, if you say this one, this is allocated in the stack. So we are not using new. So if you want to allocate in the heap, we have to use this new and use a pointer as well. So this is the way we are allocating in the stack. Okay. So now I will show you how to use the stack. So we have our code segment, and then we have first stack, main stack, and we have one variable here, only x, and then we have the second stack, which is this is main stack, and this is func a stack, and here we have variable y, and then we have integer pointer variable p. So this p variable is created in the stack. So this is stack. So this is a normal variable. So it's a type is in a pointer. So this is created in the p is in the stack. But now this memory is created in the heap. So we have heap memory. So here this is a heap. Okay, and here we create 10 integer whatever. Okay, and so this is created in the heap, and using new will return the address, and that address will be stored here. Okay, so this is what happens in the heap, and now when you return from this function, when you return this function to here, so when you return this function to here, when you finish the function, you will return this function to here, and this y and p will be deleted because this stack is deleted, and you can see now this memory is not deleted, it will be there permanently until your program. Your program, when your program exit, this memory will be free, but until that, this this memory, this array will be there until the execution of that program. So if you do this several times, you can see this memory will be, the heap memory will be filled, because every time when you call the function, you allocate this memory and you don't delete it. So this heap memory will be filled, and after some time your memory will be out of your memory will be out, so your program will be will crash. Okay, so you have to be very careful when you are creating memory in the heap. You have to manually delete when the memory is not needed. Okay, so this is the difference between stack memory and heap memory. So we will so we have 10 minutes more, so we will write this small program and see. So I will start sharing this. Okay. So so the same thing. So we have two scopes. So one is void function A, and we have two functions. So we have integer x, integer y, so equals 10 equals 20. And here int, say same variable name, b, and we will see. So I will put two breakpoints, one is here and maybe one is here. So we have to call the function. Okay, so we will call it. So when you run it, I will put the breakpoint here and go one by one. So you run it and you will stop here. And still you have variable x is created, but it's still I am here. So I haven't executed this line. So I can execute this line by, I can go over this. So now you can see x is created and initialized to 10. And now y is created, but it is not initialized yet. I run to the next line. Okay, so now this is initialized to 30. Now I will go into this function. I will put F11, that is step into, it will go to this function now. Okay, and I will go one line by line. So now X is created. So now you can see you have a new scope, new stack. So you don't see the previous variables now. So you have only X. So earlier X and this X is different, because this is a different memory location. Earlier it was 10 value, but now it is not initialized. You can see there's no, so if I go here, so now it will be 11. Okay, and then I will go here. Now it will come here. So now you can see now this 11 is not there anymore because it was in a different stack. Okay, so we cannot access it now. Okay, so now you cannot access this now. Okay, so now we will examine one by one. Okay, so now we will create integer pointer new in 10. Okay, and so what will happen is we will return say integer pointer. Instead of void, we will return a value now, and we have to return a pointer. So we will return the value of p. Okay. And now, so what happened? So I will explain this. Now I will store this pointer again, say p, something like that. So we will see what happens now. So I will run this. So what happened is we have x and y in this main stack, and then call function a. So it will start a new stack and create 11 and create this in the stack and return this one. And now you can say I will say here p 0 equals 11122. And now we have cout p 0. Okay, so now I will run this line by line. You create x and assign 10, 30, and okay. I step over the function, step over, and I step into the function, and I will go one by one. So you have x, and now you have another variable, local variable p, and now you have p 0. Equals 11, and you return p. Okay, so you are going to return this value, and now you can see this value has a value. Okay, so this value is returned from that function, and then you print that value. So you have 122. So you assign 122 here, and now you can access that 122 because this memory was created in the stack. And even though you exit from the function, you delete your heap variable, sorry, stack variable, but your heap variable is not deleted. Okay, so now you can access these variables in the function. Okay. Okay, what happened? No. So now, so we will change this. So now what happened was we create this in the stack, And when we exit from the function, exit from the function, you delete this tag. But since this was created in a heap, we can access this memory. Okay. So now what we will do is we will do something instead of heap. We will create this in the stack. Say 100. A 100. A 0 is 122, and we are returning the address of A. Okay. So what happened is we create a memory in the stack. So sometimes this will, this can work, because sometimes even the stack is deleted, we can access that memory even though this is created. So we will see what happens. Okay, so we create x, create y, call the function. Okay, still you have that memory, but you can see now that you should print 122. So you, so what we did was we create an array in the stack now. Okay, we create the array in the stack, 100 or maybe 1000 or 10,000, whatever, because when we have a large memory in the stack, it will automatically delete it anyway. So we have an array of 10,000, and we store the 122 in the first element of the array, and we return the address of the first address, the location of first A. A means the A0, address of A0 to the, from the function, and that address is stored here. So this address is the first address of this one, and now we are going to print the first value of that array. So it's in, this is P0 is same as A0, because we are returning the address of A and we are storing it here. Okay, so we will see what happens. So I will move over. Okay, this time it works. Sometimes it will not work. Okay. But in the previous time it didn't work. Okay, so then this time you can see value of P0 is a garbage value, because this array was deleted in the stack, so it may be replaced with another value. So that is why we have a garbage value. Okay, so this is you have to be careful. Okay, so when you create in the stack, the values will be deleted, but when you create in the heap, they are not deleted. You can use it in a random order, and you can use them, you can delete them in random order, and you can create them in random order, because they are not in the stack. So they, those will not be deleted when you return from functions. Okay, when you exit from functions. So that is the different, but the speed is very high in the this one. Okay. Okay, so the time is up. So I will send you some tutorial, and especially how I will show you how to, I will upload some videos how to what you call create the environment, and I will upload the video as well to the LMS. Just follow it if you cannot follow it now. And so you should start programming. That is the main thing you have to start. Okay, not like in the first two semesters. Now you have to definitely start programming, because it will be you will need them. It will need them in robotics or in Arduino or any microcontroller programming or anything, image processing, telecommunication, power systems. Anywhere you will need to write programs. Okay, so this is very important. So you should start programming. So we will have some like tutorial session later for your questions. Okay, so you have any questions? Do you have any questions from this session?
No, sir.
Okay, so then we will stop. So I will have to schedule maybe more lectures outside this